All right, well, we'll go ahead and we'll make sure as people join in, we'll be able to address things as we go, but I don't want to waste time. And so if you join in with us, you're hearing it right now, go ahead and give me a text, let me know that you're in. And since Tom and them are in, Tom had an interesting question. We'll start off with the question first, and then we'll pray, we'll get into our study together. That's the wrong Tom. All right, Tom, where are you? There you are. So Tom asked this question, and so he asked about, with our discussion of the Holy Spirit, Jesus, it says in John, John 20, that Jesus breathed on them, being the disciples, and they received the Holy Spirit. And he said that he didn't wanted to understand how that, in relation to Pentecost, did the Holy Spirit come to the disciples when Jesus breathed on them in John 20, or did Jesus send the Holy Spirit to them, as we've been talking about, he's going to send the Holy Spirit, did he come on the day of Pentecost? And so that's a very, very good question. I want to tell you that many scholars and many people all through the theological community have different opinions on this. Many of them said that the birth of the church actually occurred there at John 20 when Jesus breathed on the disciples and they received the Holy Spirit. So they would say that is the birthplace of the church. They received the Holy Spirit there. That's the true birthplace of the church, not Pentecost. There's others that say, no, Pentecost is the birthplace of the church. That's when the Holy Spirit came in power and 3,000 people were saved. So who's right? Well, it's not that easy. We always have to search through the scriptures and figure out what's going on so that we know how to process and how to understand what the Word of God says about, you know, the Holy Spirit. These are all important matters for us. And by the way, so I can acknowledge them, I believe that Tina and Dusty are online with us as well. Welcome to you guys as well. So this is how I answered Tom. I actually have studied this before, and I need to study it more, but this was my answer to him. When you compare John 20:22 with Luke 24:45, the opening of their minds to the scriptures parallels Jesus' breathing in them the Holy Spirit. We also understand from 1 Corinthians 2 that the Holy Spirit is the one who brings illumination of the scriptures. What do I mean by this? Well, if you compare what Luke's gospel says, Luke's gospel is the parallel, and actually, yeah, I'll put it in there, Luke 24:45, you can go there real quick and look at it. It's the parallel passage in the gospel of Luke with the passage there in John 20. Jesus arrives to them in the house, they're hiding, they've been locked up in the house, and Jesus appears before them. And as he appears before them, in one, they enjoy his presence, and one, he says, he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. And then John, it says that he breathed on them the Holy Spirit. So if these are parallel passages, is it a biblical hermeneutic? Is it okay to go, okay, can we take a very obscure passage that says that he breathed the Holy Spirit on them? Can we take that and go, how can we find clarity to that passage? Well, you go to another account that could shed some more light on what is really going on. So we go to the Gospel of Luke, who records that very same moment. Now, Luke's gospel is going to focus on things differently than John's gospel. John is the mystic. He is very spiritual in nature. When you look at his gospel, it's very spiritual. His point, as we've covered here before, is that Jesus is the Son of God. He is deity. He is fully God. That's what John's gospel is focusing on. He's really answering, at that time, the Gnostics, who were bringing a bunch of heretical things into the church, these wrong ideas. So Luke's gospel, though, he focuses on Jesus' humanity, and he's going to focus on that. Mark is going to focus on Jesus as king, and Mark is going to focus on Jesus as servant. And so you have to understand that when the gospel says different things, you have to understand, like any book, they're going to focus on a perspective of who Jesus is. As I said yesterday, praise God that I didn't marry myself. I married my wife, and she's different from me. And because of that, there is a variety. There's more fullness there with differences. And so John's going to see differences than what Luke's going to see. And Mark's going to see differences than Mark will see. And that doesn't mean that there is error. It doesn't mean that they're wrong. One's right, one's wrong. They just see it from a different lens. And so we get to see Jesus in four facets from the four Gospels and see a better picture of who Jesus is. That's something that's really encouraging for us. So when we go to John 20, I want you to see this. When you go to John 20 and you read there what he's saying in this passage when he breathes on them the Holy Spirit, on John 20, 22, this is what he says in we'll start in verse 19. So when it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and when the doors were shut where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in their midst. And he said to them, "Peace be with you." And when he had said this, he showed them both his hands and his side. The disciples then rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I send you." Now stop there. Jesus said, after they see Jesus alive, after they see him appear before them, Jesus says, "Peace be to you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." What does that sound like? A commissioning, right? A commissioning. He's sending them. He's sending them out with a commissioning. Now, this will make sense. I'm going to tie this with my study today as we get to that third or so point. And it says this in verse 22, right after that, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I send you." And when he had said this, so that "and" connects that prior statement, right? It's a conjunction. It's a connecting conjunction. He says "and," meaning what he just said, he's connecting with what is happening now. "And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, 'Receive the Holy Spirit.'" And then he says, "If you forgive the sins of any, their sins have been forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they have been retained." Now, that's another subject for another day, but basically what we're seeing is what is going on here in John 20 is a commissioning. He's sending them out. Now, we have to come to grips of, is this a sending out right now, or is this preparing them for a later sending? And I would with the way I see it, John 20 is a picture of what is happening, what Jesus will do with the Holy Spirit. He even tells us in John 16, when I go away, I will send you the Holy Spirit, and he will bring to your mind all the things that I've taught you. And we understand that the Holy Spirit is responsible for illumination. Without the Holy Spirit's work of convicting and of illumination, we can't understand the scriptures. We cannot understand, and we're not going to be able to really obey the scriptures, because without faith, it's impossible to please God. And so we see the work of the Holy Spirit, and I would say with the best study that I have, the best light that I have, that the birthplace of the church indeed is Acts 2, the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit came in power. So what's happening here? Jesus is giving them maybe even a partial blessing of the fuller blessing that's to come. He's preparing them for when he will send them out with the power of the Holy Spirit, which is to come about 40 days from that point. And he's going to send them out in power, and they're going to be his witnesses, his apostles, apostelos, apo being the Greek preposition for out of, and the stelos being sent out. So you've got this word apostle is really literally being sent out. The sent out ones. That's what it means to be an apostle, to be sent out. Just like a disciple is to be a learner. These words are very important. We refer to them as the disciples, but we miss out on the word that Jesus calls us to be disciples. He calls us also to function as apostles. I wouldn't want to have the title of an apostle, but we need to have the function of an apostle. And the function of an apostle is to be sent out. We have to be sent out of the church walls into the world to evangelize and to preach the good news. And so that's very important. We also operate as evangelists. We preach the good news. We have the good news. We should be preaching and proclaiming the good news. We also function as prophets. And a prophet is not someone who just foretells things. He's a foreteller. He's a forth teller with the TH there. He tells people, he proclaims the truth of who Jesus is, and Jesus is coming again for his church. And so in all these functions, we function as disciples, we function even as deacons, we function as ministers, we function as apostles, we function as disciples, we function in these ways. But God has, in his word, has revealed certain offices, that being of a deacon and that being of a pastor. All of us should be in the midst of a shepherding. Aren't fathers shepherds of their families? And so there is a process of shepherding, of pastoring, but God has called select men to fulfill the role or the office of a pastor and also that of a deacon or and also as an elder. So anyway, hopefully that clears up the question there. Tom asked a very, very hard question. It's not a very easy question about how do you connect these two? And if you want more information, I mean, there is great commentaries that I could point you to. I actually have a copy I could send out, a little note from a selection of a commentary that I was able to actually copy and paste. And so if you would like that, I can send that to you. It probably will bring up more questions than answers, but it's a good start. Because we need to understand the role of the Holy Spirit, amen? He is functioning. He is the executor of our faith. And that's why we are spending time talking about these things. Now, let me see if someone just texted me. Okay, so we're hearing from our YouTube audience that the sound quality is really not that good. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to step off real quick, and we don't have another mic, so I can't ask y'all to pray. But give me a second. This is a little dance here that we're going to be doing, and then hopefully our YouTube audience can hear us pretty well. So give me 1 second. I'll be right back. All right, hopefully that might be a little bit better. All right, so those on YouTube, can you hear that? Is that a little bit better for you guys? We want y'all to be happy. All right, I also want to invite, how many do we have on YouTube right now?
Seven.
I believe, I've talked with my parents, they have driven 12 hours, well, a little less than that, but they've driven all day today to go from Memphis, Tennessee, down to Jacksonville, Florida, to be with my grandfather and my grandmother. We call them Mama Epp and Papa Epp, and my Papa Epp is not doing so well, and so they're going to be with family and be with him, and so appreciate your prayers for my Papa Epp. But they're there. They just arrived a little while ago, probably about 30 minutes ago, and so I told them, hey, if you want to, you can always get online, and I'll be here, and you can watch, and they can get to see me, because all right, good. We're much better on the volume. So anyway, I want to give a shout-out to my mom and Poppy up if they're watching. I love them dearly. They're all way on the other side of the coast, and so we're far in distance, but their impact in my family's life and my life goes beyond. So isn't that wonderful about being disciple makers? Your impact continues even when you get to an age where you can't really invest that much into people. You spend your younger years investing, and you continue on until you breathe your last. But guess what? That our influence can go on even when we're long dead and gone. And that's the beauty of disciple making, is that our impact, the impact that the Holy Spirit makes in us into other people that we disciple, it goes on beyond we can even imagine. We honor the Lord in a few things, and if we do that, as he says, you are accountable, and you did things well and with a few things, and I will make you over many things, accountable for many things. So anyway, praise God for that. All right, any other questions, any other things out there in the YouTube universe? All right, we have a question here in the audience. And Luke actually says that. He made careful inquiries and searches. He was a historian, so he had to go to firsthand accounts to get all that. Of course, he was inspired by the Holy Spirit, too, when he did write, but he did do his research. And so, yeah, Luke, he researched this. He knew the apostles. He was, of course, with Paul for many of these journeys, and definitely, I would imagine he talked with Mary. Well, yeah, so a lot of this is from not only revelation from the Holy Spirit. I mean, really, could God have just given Luke all these things without him actually inquiring? Yeah, he could have. That's what we believe by inspiration of the Holy Spirit. It's a work that he provides. We are the resources, but Luke specifically says that he made careful inquiries. So he definitely went to the source and got that, and then the Holy Spirit inspired that knowledge into his holy word. And so, yeah, but you see how Luke, and to talk to your point there, Luke is writing later. He's writing after the fact, and so he's focusing, of course, on Jesus as mankind, because there's also, as I said before, this heresy going on that Jesus was either more God than he was man, or that he was more man than he was God. And so the Gospels come and say, no, he's fully God, he's fully man. He came as a king, but he also is the servant. He is the humble, obedient servant that we see even through the servant songs, specifically Isaiah 50 that comes to mind. All right, so any other questions before we go on? We'll pray, and then we'll get into our study. All right. If you're on YouTube and you want to have a question, then go ahead and submit those, and I'll try to get to them when I can. But let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for this time together that we get to look into the convicting role of the Holy Spirit. Thank you for the many times that we've already looked at these two other parts, and now we're finishing this third part on how he convicts, and this is a very important thing for us to know as we are aware of people around us that begin to be convicted by our witness, and how we can be aware of what the work of the Holy Spirit, so that we can encourage that work and we can be mindful of that and use that as a strategy to even be more productive and more effective in our gospel witness. Holy Spirit, we thank you that you are one who you have been given to us to dwell in us so that we might have communion even with the Father. We might have relationship and a knowledge that even comes from your illuminating work in our lives. We also thank you for your sanctifying work and how you make us more and more like Jesus every day. And Lord, we pray for those who maybe consider themselves Christians but yet are not becoming more like Jesus every day, that they would really begin to stop and think, do they really know Jesus? And do they really have the born-again experience that only comes by the work of the Holy Spirit and from no other? This is not by anything that we do, not anything by which we know. This comes with a radical transformation that only is brought out by God, and of course was brought out even from the beginning of time itself. Today, Lord Jesus, by the work of your Holy Spirit, I pray that you will allow this study to bless those who are not only here today, but also those who are online. And I ask that you will receive glory, that as we are edified and as we are instructed and as we grow in our knowledge and awareness of the Holy Spirit's work, Lord, that we would definitely treat him even more kindly, be more aware of his presence, that we would be careful not to grieve the Holy Spirit, and that we would be careful also not to quench his work. Give us knowledge. Allow us to become more and more of who you want us to be, and that is the person of Jesus Christ. Thank you for this time tonight. Bless it in your holy name we pray. Amen. All right, so if you were in John 20, go back to John 16. We're looking at the convicting work of the Holy Spirit. As I've said before, we've covered many things before. First of all, we looked at, if I can find out my notes here, we looked at the meaning. Let's see, what point is this? This is the means of conviction. We looked at the meaning of conviction. We looked at the means of conviction. We also looked at the manner of conviction. And then I believe we moved on, we ended there, and now we are at this one right here. Today we're going to look at the manifestation of the Holy Spirit's conviction. That's the manifestation of the Holy Spirit's conviction. If you will, read with me in the Gospel of John, chapter 6, and we'll look at where we left off last time. Let's go ahead and just start at verse 5, and we'll go and we'll stop where it's a good spot. Verse 5 says this, "But now I am going to him who sent me," and who sent Jesus Christ? Who sent the Son? The Father. And we actually just looked at that, right, in John 20. He goes, "As the Father has sent me, I also send you." If you really look at it, Jesus is our example, isn't he? Jesus is a sent one, obeying his Father. But we also are sent ones that have been sent out by our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And Jesus perfectly obeyed his Father, and we also must be obedient to the Father and to the Son. And all this is possible only because of the Holy Spirit's sealing work in our life. He is in us if we are born again. And so he says continually there in verse 6, "But because I have said these things to you, being that he was going away, sorrow has filled your heart." Verse 7, "But I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And he, when he comes, will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment." Now, these are very important. We covered that last time, remember? What does it mean that the Holy Spirit's work is going to convict the world of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment? If you don't know what those are, you need to go back to part two, and you need to go look at that again, part one and part two, because you need to get that down. You need to know that, exactly what that means. If somebody says, "Hey, what does that mean?" that you'll know right then how to answer them accordingly. I'm going to bring that back up again today about what that means and how that functions in our lives. So he says he's going to convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment, concerning sin because they do not believe in me, concerning righteousness because I go to the Father and you no longer see me, and concerning judgment because the ruler of this world has been judged. I have many more things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all the truth. For he will not speak on his own initiative, but whatever he hears, he will speak. And he will disclose to you what is to come. He will glorify me, for he will take of mine and will disclose it to you. All things the Father has are mine. Therefore, I said that he takes of mine and will disclose it to you. So it goes from the Father to the Son and through the Son by the Holy Spirit to us. There's a few things I want to mention as we get started with this. You know, there's a lot of people today that have really abused and have concocted a theology about the Holy Spirit that is just not true. They focus more on the Holy Spirit than they do on Jesus Christ. There's people out there, I guess you could say, they focus more on the Father than they do on the Son. And there's others that focus more on Jesus to the exclusion of the Holy Spirit. And there's some that would focus on the Holy Spirit more than their focus on Jesus Christ. And I would say we have to have a balanced view of this. The scriptures show this. All you have to do is open up to Ephesians 1 and you can see that. You see the work of the Father in saving you. You can see the work of the Son in saving you. You can see the work of the Holy Spirit in saving you. All three persons of the Godhead is necessary in salvation. One is no greater than the other. But as Baptists, as specifically Southern Baptists, and I do believe that convictionally, I believe that Southern Baptists are more close to the Scriptures than any other denomination. That's why I are one. I am a Southern Baptist because I believe convictionally that our theology, the theology that we have laid down, the way that we look at our church and the church order and the nature of the church, the structure of the church, the government of the church, the mission of the church, I believe Southern Baptists closely reflect the true intentions of Scripture. When you look at the Southern Baptists, they're one of the greatest missionary forces on the planet today. Hopefully that will be, well, I don't want to say hopefully, but right now we're seeing a great move in South Korea, and they possibly actually will outnumber the amount of missionaries going out onto the mission field than even North American missionaries. But regardless, Southern Baptists have had a great and rich heritage in mission, and that goes back to our theology. It goes back to what we see. I don't want to say that we don't agree with many things with our brothers and sisters in Christ and Methodism and with Presbyterianism or Reformed theology. I'm not saying that. There's brothers and sisters in Christ that I love and respect. Actually, many of my family came from a Lutheran background. And so we are not belittling other denominations. They are. If they believe by faith in Lord Jesus Christ, they are brothers and sisters in Christ. But there are some tertiary and there are some things in Scripture that are important, like what we believe about baptism, what we believe about many things. And we don't have enough time today to go through all the little things here. But the thing is we believe a certain way about baptism that others don't believe. That's probably one of the reasons why we're called Baptists, because we believe that baptism is reserved only for believers. Many denominations that actually broke out of the Roman Catholic Church, they believe that you, by identifying with the covenant, the new covenant, as Presbyterians do, that baptism is a sign of the covenant. So you can baptize babies, and that's just okay. We look at the Scriptures, and we go, who do we see is being baptized? We see in Acts 2, we see all through, that it's believers who are being baptized, that they are saved by the work of the Holy Spirit in them, they're regenerated. And then baptism then is a picture of that inward reality that is made manifest to all people who are in the viewing of that time. They're looking at a gospel picture in that baptism. They're representing themselves, who they were, dying to themselves, and then by the power of the Holy Spirit being raised again. And so that's the picture of baptism. It pictures the gospel.
They didn't call him John the Sprinkler.
Yeah, they didn't call him John the Sprinkler, and they call him John the Baptist. Yeah, that's right. And baptism, that word, Greek word baptizo, actually literally means immersion. It means to dunk. It means to, you know, douse and wet the individual completely. I guess you could do that with sprinkling, but that would be a lot of water. You might as well just go ahead and dunk them in there. Now, anyway, so here we're looking at this manifestation of the Holy Spirit's conviction. The truth of the convicting and convincing work of the Holy Spirit deserves much more investigation than what we have given to it. In our teaching, in our preaching, and even in our witnessing, we generally don't give much thought to the work of the Holy Spirit and how he manifests that convicting work. It's very closely related to the level of our Christian living. The neglect of this truth and our poor expectation with regard to the Holy Spirit's conviction has left the quality of Christian living in our day much lower than it should be. And if there is anything to write down, I would probably write down this. It is a general rule that grace tends to grow strongest in the experience of the believer in whom conviction of sin has pierced the deepest. Let me say that again. It is a general rule that grace tends to grow strongest in the experience of the believer in whom conviction of sin has pierced deepest. What do I mean by that? I mean that in your salvation experience, those who come away from that understanding a much more realistic, deeper knowledge of grace, usually, usually have also experienced the greatest convicting work in their life. When you see how unholy you are and the depths of your depravity, God's grace meets that deep need, and you see how rich that grace is. When we see how rich grace is, it necessarily shows us how morally bankrupt and corrupt we are. The more and more unholy you see yourself, the more and more you need God's grace. And so remember, Jesus spoke a story about, it was a parable. He talked about this one woman who had a lot of things and how she or he was forgiven much, and then on this other person, he forgives them, and it was just for a little bit. And so then Jesus asked this question, which one loves the other more? And the one person responds, the one who is forgiven much loves more. And so let me say it one more time. It is a general rule that grace, now I'm not saying absolute, I'm saying general. It's a general rule that grace tends to grow strongest in the experience of the believer in whom conviction of sin has pierced deepest. I have the opportunity as a pastor to counsel many individuals and to have many relationships with people. And it's interesting to me that there are many, many times that people really are unaware of how sinful they are. And sometimes it's just not my job to say, man, I just wanted to tell you how prideful you are. When the Holy Spirit opens the door, that can be the opportunity, but you probably would not think of me as your best friend if I were to come to you and say, you know what, I've watched your life, I've evaluated your life, and I really have come to the conclusion that you're one of the most narcissistic people that I've ever been around. And now, I will tell you this, that's a true best friend that's willing to tell you hard things. I can only, right now, unless the Holy Spirit opens that door, I'm very sensitive to that, especially in counseling, I can go right there because, I mean, they're asking for it. they're in problems, they're in trouble, and we, if we really are realistic, everyone needs counseling. God's word says, in the multitude of counselors, there is wisdom. So I don't want to say that counseling is only for the really bad people. It's actually for more normal people than you think. The people who don't think they need counseling are the very ones that actually need counseling more than the people who are actually in counseling. And it takes a lot of awareness of their own selves, and their own sin, to say, you know what, we need help. And that's God's grace, right? When he reveals to you the need that, hey, my goodness, we've got a problem. And we need to go seek out wise counsel for this. That is, you are more ahead of the game than you are for people who think they have everything figured out and everything under their belt. I believe humility definitely is one of those key things that we need to really strive to attain. We'll never attain it, but we need to be wise. We need to be wise, and by being wise, we need to be humble with ourselves and acknowledge how morally bankrupt we are, how depraved we really are. We are wicked. We are evil. And if we don't see that, if we just go around and practice the culture and say, oh, well, you know, our greatest need is that we have to have self-esteem. You know, I just don't have enough self-esteem. Then we're really fooling ourselves. The thing is God's word doesn't say that our problem is self-esteem, but the problem is sin. And the middle word in that, the middle letter in that word sin is I. I mean, that is the definition of sin, is selfishness, pride. We can even say the root of all sin is pride. It's the me lifestyle. It's not your way, Lord, but my way. That's pride. That's the beginning of sin right there. And so and unless we see how morally bankrupt and corrupt and depraved we are, then we're really not going to see how great God's grace is. You've heard me say this before, and I keep saying it again because I want it to make sense, and I want it to just to, you know, knock against the head to where you can see it clearly. The good news is only the good news unless you really realize how bad the bad news is. And we live in a society today that believes everyone is good, that man is inherently good. Do you know how difficult it is to witness to people who think they're already really good? The thing is by the convicting work of the Holy Spirit, they begin to see how awful and how evil they really are. That's why no one can be saved unless the Holy Spirit is working in their life to show them how awful they really are. And no one can be saved unless they've been convicted of their sin. You just don't hear about Jesus here. Oh, yeah, he's a pretty cool guy. Yeah, he died on the cross. Yeah, he raised again. Hey, you know what? If I pray this prayer, I'm going to heaven. I've seen so many people have prayed the prayer of salvation, but they never acknowledge their sin. They never even, it never comes out of their mouth, Lord, I repent for my sin. Remember in Acts 2, the people there at in the gathering when Peter was preaching, they came to the apostles and they said, what must we do? And what did Peter say?
Repent.
Repent and believe on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and you shall be saved. We've completely missed out on the big word, repentance, because why? We're too proud. We want Jesus for what he gives us, but we don't want Jesus for who he is. And that's a problem, and we've got to be very sensitive to that. So how much conviction is necessary in a true salvation experience? This goes back, I'm going to read it one more time, for some of you who have problems taking notes. Is a general rule that grace tends to grow strongest in the experience of the believer in whom conviction of sin has pierced deepest. So how much conviction is necessary in a true salvation experience then? That's a great question that follows up that statement. In 1 Corinthians 12:6, Paul wrote that there are different kinds of working of the Spirit, but the same God works of all of them in all men. Some people like John Bunyan and Martin Luther had great convicting works of the Holy Spirit. They went through incredible agony. If you understand what happened to Martin Luther went through a time where it was like a lot of penance, that he was like just, he was so overcome by his sin. And he got so low and so deep in just a bad spot, we would say, that he finally understood that he couldn't do anything about his sin. He was so consumed by his sin and trying to get rid of his sin, and then he found out that that's what justification by faith means. And that's why he began this reformation, because why? Because the only way we believe that sins are not taken away by what we do, the Catholic Church teaches that it's these grace gifts or these that grace is imparted for what you do, but that justification by faith actually means that when you come by faith, that you're completely justified. And there's no work that you have to do to get rid of your sin. It's gone. As far as the east is from the west, it's gone. Justified by faith. But we see men like John Bunyan and Martin Luther who had these great, just convicting moments of the Holy Spirit before the light of Christ's righteousness burst into their lives. Personally, there are some that like me and others like my wife that may have not had such great, convicting salvation experiences. I was saved at the age of 9. I was convicted. I had a conviction, but it wasn't like I was going through the fire. Like you could see, maybe look at some great convicting works of like John Bunyan and even like Paul the Apostle. I mean, wasn't his salvation experience? I mean, God put a grip on him, right? But others, like myself and maybe even like Lydia, remember Lydia back over in Acts 16? I mean, her salvation experience was very quiet. Maybe not as loud as Paul the Apostle, but was very quiet. It didn't seem very radical. Seemed like, all right, you want to follow Christ? Oh, well, wow. So she began to follow Christ. So does that mean that Paul the Apostle or John Bunyan or Martin Luther are more saved than I am because they had a greater salvation experience and had a greater conviction of their sin than I did when I was 9 years old? No. That doesn't mean that at all. Many others had varying degrees of conviction, and somewhere between these extremes, we can find ourselves possibly in those. But I personally believe that three things may determine the depth of the conviction. So this is important. There are three things that I have determined that were the three things that would determine maybe the depth of the conviction. Number one, the depth of sin's entrenchment in the sinner's life may account for the degree of conviction he receives. If he is an absolute rebel like Paul was, the Holy Spirit may treat him very roughly to prepare him for salvation. If you're deep in sin, Paul even said, I'm the chief of sinners. If you're deep in sin, let's just say we have like these, you know, MS-13 or whatever that gang is called, or if you have just these people who are just radically evil, then possibly, I can't say wholeheartedly, but God does what he would, but I would sense to say that they who are deep in sin would probably have a more rough dealing with the Holy Spirit in their salvation testimony than maybe I was when I was 9 years old and really hadn't come to a full, maybe, you know, I had an awareness of sin, but it wasn't like I had gone out and murdered someone the worst thing that I did that my mom caught me as I stole one of those little wooden pencils from Home Depot. You know, that cost like 25 cents. You know, it wasn't shaved. And so I got home and I began to get a knife, and because I had seen my dad do it, and I was just trying to mimic my dad. And I took it and I started chopping it and trying to make it into a pencil. And mom caught me. She goes, "Where did you get that?" I don't know. Well, my mom. Yeah, my mom, she took me back to the store and scared the living daylights out of me. She said, you know, she took me back into the manager's office, and she said, "I want you to scare the living daylights out of him." She goes, "I want you to call the cops. I want you to just, I want you, I mean, he's a thief." And that's exactly what they did. They threatened me, and I was like, I'm just so sorry. I would never do that again. And, but, you know, that was a lesson that said, you know what? I'm grateful for those moments that my mom really took sin like that, as it was just 25 cents. Maybe that by that time was like, I don't know, 5 or 10 cents. I mean, it was nothing. But it was enough to say, we need to stomp out that root of robbery before it manifests into a really big tree that could be a big problem. But, I mean, I didn't grow up, you know, far from the Lord. I didn't get into a life of partying, drinking, and sexual immorality. I didn't do that. That doesn't mean that I was less evil. God sees me as evil as anyone else is evil. But consequences of sin and depths of sin, I have been, Lord, thank goodness I've been spared from. And so my conviction experience was probably not as deep or as rough as others. Another purpose, number two, purpose God may have for him after conversion may determine how God prepares him for it through conviction. If he is being prepared for maybe an exceptional fruitful ministry or a ministry in a very hard place, God may tighten the vise of conviction more fully on him in order to give him special equipment through salvation. He may be preparing that person for a really great ministry or for ministry in a really, really hard to reach area. And so his convicting work is probably going to be stronger and more forceful than maybe on others. Again, this is determined by God alone. You can't say, "Oh, okay, God, I want to do great things for you. Really bring on the conviction." That's God's. He is the one that places you where he wills, right? And some he's going to place in a really hard area to reach. He's probably going to put some of us in areas that no one would ever know our name. A no-name area, or he may put us like Billy Graham into the national spotlight. We can't determine that ourselves. I don't care how hard you work, how much Bible study you're in. Those type of people that God prepares and God puts in those positions. And if you want to try to attain that, you're doing it in your own work and not in his work. A third way in which we can see this is that the nature of his temperament, the person's temperament and the personality, may determine the apparent degree of conviction he receives from the Holy Spirit. If he is a mild manner person, it's not likely he's going to receive a lightning or a thunder conviction. But if he has a volatile personality, he may be shaken with conviction more than others. If this assessment is accurate, we may be sure that we can count on the all-wise God to give a suitable degree of conviction That is required for each individual case. I'm just giving you some three observations that I'm not able to really maybe prove biblically. God doesn't speak directly to that, but I do believe that we do see that there are varying degrees of conviction, right? We see that some people are wrung out and some others just kind of come freely. Is one more saved than the other? No, they're all saved, but God has different levels and degrees of conviction in those ways. An old Puritan adage says this: God suits the north wind to fit the shorn lamb. That is, the different kinds of working of the Spirit will fit the necessity of each person. So the manifestation of the Spirit in convicting sinners really may vary widely, but I do not believe that a sinner is even saved, though, without the convicting work of the Spirit. The conviction of the Spirit of God precedes salvation. I can also point you to 2 Corinthians chapter 7, which says that there's two types of sorrow or two types of conviction. One is worldly sorrow or worldly conviction, where maybe you do something wrong, you go and you get caught stealing a 25-cent pencil from Home Depot, and you go to jail. Well, don't you feel pretty bad about yourself? Isn't there a sorrow there? Oh, my goodness, I cannot believe this. This is an awful day. I'm going to jail for what I did. I did wrong, right? I broke the law. I stole something that wasn't mine. But that's a conviction, right? That's a sorrow there, but is that salvation? Is that conviction that can lead me to salvation? No, it's just worldly sorrow. I feel really sorry about the situation, and I feel really bad about it. But there's another type of sorrow, and that's godly sorrow. And Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 7 that godly sorrow always produces repentance that leads to salvation. So you see that you can't be saved, you can't experience salvation unless you have experienced conviction. And this is very, very important. When we are witnessing to individuals, when we are telling people the gospel, if they're like, yeah, I don't really care, you know, yeah, I want to go to heaven, I'm not really interested in Jesus, I'm not really interested in going to church, I'm not really interested in, you know, doing those things. I mean, that's kind of old school, right? Going to church these days, going to the gathering, that's old school. I can do that online. I can hear much better preachers than John Epstein online now. I can go and I can listen to great bands online. I don't need that. I don't need a relationship with other local believers. I don't need that. That's too old school. You know what? Yeah, I'll pray the prayer. Yeah, you've convinced me. I'll pray the prayer, and then yeah, I have fire insurance. If you don't even evaluate any kind of conviction in their life, then I would be very careful and be very honest with them about where they are. That doesn't mean, as I said, like Lydia, if I was counseling Lydia and she just didn't have this, like if I were Paul and I had this traumatic, you know, salvation experience, I'm like, well, Lydia, you know, it doesn't seem like you're crying. It doesn't seem like you're weeping. It doesn't seem like you're really convicted. I don't really think you're saved. I would be very careful there, but I think it's also necessary that we see some kind of conviction of sin. They understand that they are sinners, first of all, and that they're broken about their sin. And some people are going to relate that differently. Some are going to cry and weep, and some are going to be really saddened, but they're not going to weep. Some people emotionalize things inwardly more than outwardly, right? We're all different. The basis of this is that what I want to show is that conviction must be present for it to lead to salvation. That's just God's word. Yes, sir.
Many are called, but few are chosen. That could be a venue of the Holy Spirit. So my question would be, do you think everybody is one time or another in their life convicted by the Holy Spirit? Or are there some people that maybe are never convicted?
Wow, that's a great question. If you're on our online community and probably weren't able to hear Dave there, he said basically the question is, everyone who has ever lived in the world have they had at least one time by which they've received conviction? So they had an opportunity to be saved, right? I mean, is it possible that everyone who has ever lived has had at least one opportunity to be convicted of their sin so that they would be able to trust in the Lord? And it's not a very pleasant answer, but I would say no. What do you do with the person who is in the Amazon rainforest that has never heard of Jesus Christ? Can they be saved? Can they even receive the convicting work that leads to salvation? I don't believe so. Because why? Salvation, or faith comes by what? Hearing, and hearing by the word of Christ. We must go, you go, well, that's not fair. These people have never heard about Jesus. They're going to hell. God must do something about it. Well, God has already determined to do something about it, and that's to send us, to send us to the world, to unreached people groups. That's why, as I go back to Southern Baptist again, that's why I'm a Southern Baptist. Why? Because we are the most mission-minded denomination in America right now. We're sending people all over the world. We have more of a mighty missionary force than any other. So I would say, Dave, that under some other things that I want to get into right now, because they're I don't want to say they're on another level, but I would say that God, if you read Romans 8, that he is predestined, he has foreknown, he has called, he has justified, and he is glorified there in Romans 8, 29 and on. And so God knows who he's going to call. And God's going to send his Holy Spirit. And we're going to see that actually in the next points. He's going to send his Holy Spirit to those individuals to convict them. He's not going to send his Holy Spirit to everyone. Now, does that mean that God is not going to direct them? God's grace goes to everyone. It says that he allows his grace, his common grace, to the rain comes on the wicked and the wicked and the righteous. So God is working, and he has control. It's not like he doesn't have control over, you know, every individual. He does. No one does anything outside of his knowledge and his work. But your question was specifically that convicting work. Convicting work that the Holy Spirit brings to lead people to salvation only is towards those who he's calling to trust in his Son, not to every single person in the world throughout human history. And I have some more scriptures. We can talk about that on another time in more full sense. But he's going to call specific individuals, his elect. We don't really like that word in theology, but God's going to call his elect, those he has elected. Yes, Miss Vicky.
Eddie had a question.
She's raising her hand.
For me. Great. What's up, Eddie?
No, like the Bible says, every knee shall bow.
That's at the end, though. That acknowledgement doesn't mean conviction. That means at the end, when Jesus has made even his enemies his footstool, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess the name of the glory of the God the Father. It doesn't mean that everyone's going to be saved. Everyone's going to acknowledge. So here's the deal. You're either going to acknowledge that now as a saved individual that Jesus Christ is Lord, or you're going to do it then as a reprobate, doing it against your will. But it doesn't mean that you're going to have the blessing of the eternal promise that God has given to the saved, those who he has called today in this time. By that time, it's too late.
So they have no excuse.
They have no excuse. God's word even says that, Romans 1:18, that he has made himself evident through the things that he's made, through the creation. He's made himself he's made himself known even into their innermost being, to their conscience. People know that there's a God.
Yeah.
And he says there in Romans 1:18 that they're without excuse. Yeah. But here's the deal. But Romans 1:18 is pointing to general revelation, meaning things that are seen. And when you look at the world, you know that the world was created by a God. There's order. There are laws. There is beauty. This didn't just happen. There was not some chaotic event that just put it. It would be like putting a bunch of explosives on Mount Rushmore, blowing it up, and getting the foreheads of the presidents. Just won't happen. It took intelligent beings who went and chiseled certain parts to create that work of art. okay? And that took intelligence. And when we look at our creation, we see intelligence. And that can only come from a vast, a universal, eternal God. Amen. So this is the we're talking about the manifesting work of convicting of the Holy Spirit. As we go on, we're going to look at Joseph, even in the book of Genesis. He spoke roughly to his brothers, right? Before he revealed himself. Let's see here. That's a good question, Robbie. I'm reading his question too as I'm talking. Mr. Dave, if you can, if you go back to the back on the soundboard, go to that level, the level A, and look for one that says crowd.
Says what?
It says crowd, the crowd mic, and unmute that crowd mic, and that should pick up. Now be careful. I don't want to make sure that we don't get any feedback. But this is to answer another question on our.
Is that on this big board?
It's on the big board. Go to layer A,
right.
On the, and you'll see one of the faders. It will say crowd, and you'll need to unmute that. It's probably gonna be about middle of the board. If not, I can go back there real quick. But you see it? Now we've got Miss Martha trained on Sling Studio, and now we're gonna have David trained on the soundboard, and so we're. We're moving places. But as he's doing that and figuring that out, Joseph, though, and his brothers came to him, and he'd go, oh, guys, man, I missed you. I love you. I can't believe. I'm Joseph. I'm your brother. Did he do that first, or did he really put him through the ringer? He spoke roughly to his brothers, right? You remember he put the goblet, the golden or silver goblet, in one of the bags, and says, "You thieves!" I mean, he really went, put them under a lot of stress there. So watch this. He roughly spoke to his knee brothers to bring them to a confession of their former sins. Dave, did you get to do that?
Spell it.
Crowd.
Yeah.
Did you get it on?
No. Spell
crowd. C R O W D. All right. Well, it's on layer A, and it's and you'll see Pastor PJ. You'll see some of the green blue mics, and then you'll see crowd. All right, but so Joseph spoke really rough to his brothers, and then after they confessed, right? They said, "You know what? We did have a brother," because he was like, "Hey, don't you have another brother?" Well, yeah, Benjamin. Well, where is he? He's over there. Well, you bring him here. And then he said, started saying, well, don't you have another brother? And they wouldn't admit it. They said, well, you know what? We do have another brother, but he's no longer with us. He's no longer here. Because Joseph knew they needed to admit their sin before reconciliation could happen, right? I think y'all worked it out because I'm seeing that they can hear everyone now. So I think y'all got it. So whatever you did, all right. Well, they're hearing you now. So there was some kind of ghost back there maybe. Pushed the button for us. So the Holy Spirit reproves first of our sin in order to lead us to repentance and salvation. It is the hungry man who really puts a value on bread, doesn't he? It is the guilty man who values pardon. The sinner is very likely to receive the degree of conviction that will make him willing to give up his sins and long for Christ as his Savior. It is so funny to me that people want to come to Jesus, but they don't want to live for him. They want what Jesus gives them, but they don't long to have a relationship with him, to commune with him, to study his word. I mean, when Jesus, it says in John 1:1 that the word became flesh and dwelt among us, Jesus is the word. And it's really funny to me that people will call themselves Christians, but they won't long for the word. If the word Jesus is in you, don't you think Jesus, the word, will long for his word in your life? And so if you're not spending time in the word, I see that as maybe an indication that there's something wrong with your, possibly you're either not saved. I'm not saying that. I'm just want to be honest. Really, you need somebody right now today. That's a very loving thing. Hey, you know what? There's really no indication in your life that right now you're really walking in Christ. There's no fruit of salvation. You don't long for the word of God. You come to the service, and all you complain about is we got out, you know, late. You're more concerned. You're more consumed about the time of the service than you are about the content of the service. And I began to go, why is it that people are more about their pleasures and about their accommodations than they are about God's word? Isn't that why we want to be here? We want to be here because we want to know the word. We want to know how we can honor God, how we can make disciples. That's why we're here. That's why you are watching online right now, because you go, I want to know. I want to long for the word. I want to know Jesus. I want to know how I can please him. I don't care how long it takes. I want to know Christ and him crucified. And I want to be able to serve him and live for him for my life. I long for Jesus Christ. I want to be his best friend because he's already done that for me. I want him to ooze out of my life because he has so filled up my life and been gracious to me. And so those who experience that have also experienced the depths of who they are, their wretchedness. You see how wretched you are? Guess what? You're going to be able to appreciate more the grace of God. And you're going to be able to say, you know what? Our God is so good, right? He is so good because he's so gracious. But it's funny, people they believe in cheap grace. They believe in grace that accommodates them, and they never have come to really see how awful they really are. And so this is the manifestation of the conviction of the Holy Spirit. He manifests himself in the levels of conviction, and that is to bring us about into this need for salvation. Now, fifth, we look at the mediators of this convicting work. One feature is usually overlooked in this text, but we must not be guilty of that oversight. Look again at Jesus' words there in verse 7. If you have your Bibles, look at verse 7. He says this, "But I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And he, when he comes, will convict the world." Stop there. He will convict the world. In my ministry, I would be guilty of this oversight. I thought that the text meant that the Holy Spirit would come into the world on the day of Pentecost, and he would go directly to lost sinners and convict them of their sin. Now, he may do that, but this text suggests a different course. Jesus said that the Holy Spirit will come to you, doesn't he? Look at verse 7 again. What does he say? The Holy Spirit will come to you. And I'm going to send him to you. The Helper will not come to you, but if I go, I will send him to you. Who does the Holy Spirit go to? You, me. Note the recurring reference to that recipient, to you. Read the 7th and 8th verse of the text and emphasize the word you. So let's do it real quick. Verse 7, "But I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I go away, I will send him to you." Now, he emphasizes that through this. The Holy Spirit is apparently not coming to the world as such. He is coming to you, the Christian. And when he comes to the Christian, he will convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. In fact, Jesus had earlier said specifically to his disciples in John 14, verses 16 through 18, this is what he says. "I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper." So again, he's reminding them in 14, now we're in 16, about the Holy Spirit. "And that he may be with you forever." That is the Spirit of truth. Who is the Holy Spirit? He's the Spirit of truth. Jesus said in John 14:6, right before this, right, that I am the way, the truth. So Jesus is the truth. The Spirit is the Spirit of truth. So he says, that is the Spirit of truth whom the world cannot receive. He says that. The world cannot receive because it does not see him or know him. But you know him because he abides with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. It's just the world, this is from a commentary that I read even today and I wrote down. The world, the moral order and rebellion against God cannot accept him because it neither sees him or knows him. This is profoundly materialistic. The world is suspicious of what it cannot see, but seeing in itself guarantees nothing. As the world's response to Jesus demonstrates, this truth that the world does not know the Spirit of truth and cannot accept him, and if it could, it would cease being the world. Basically, the world cannot, Jesus says, receive him because they cannot see him. Remember one of my first messages when I came to Desert Springs? I preached on Proverbs 29:18. Without vision, the people perish. Have you seen, even through the process of discipling, my emphasis on seeing from God's point of view? Seeing truly only comes from the work of the Holy Spirit. He's the one that shines the light of illumination so that you can see. That's why we preach the Word. Without faith, it's impossible to believe. Why? Because the Word is a lamp unto our feet, a light unto our path. Without the Word, you cannot see. Without light, you cannot see. And who's the one that turns the lights on? The Holy Spirit. Your heart before in your sin was darkened, it was stony, it was hard, it had no way to respond to God. So that's why God had to come in, he had to bust that heart wide open, and he had to put a new heart in, a heart of flesh, and he put his Spirit in you so he would cause you to obey him and to walk according to his statutes. That's Ezekiel, I believe, 36:22. Anyway, he, the Holy Spirit, comes to us. Now, don't miss this point. There's a purpose, right? I told you, he comes to us. But what is the work of the Holy Spirit that we talked about before? He was going to come into the world to what? Convict the world of sin, righteousness, and judgment. How does he do that? Who does he do that through? Through us. You would almost think before that it would just be, he would just go straight to that person and he would do it by himself. And in many ways, we can't do it without him, but who does he use? He uses us, and in cooperation with his church, with believers who have the Holy Spirit, we go, and it is through us that sin is pronounced, that righteousness is shown, and judgment is seen. All these things are done through the church, and it's by the power of the Holy Spirit that then they can be able to see, but he does it through the Christian. We are, in a sense, the sounding board. If you know anything about music, when you have a guitar, you have that soundboard. It's in pianos. It's that sounding board. But you're not the one making the music, but you're the one amplifying the music. So when you hit that strum, the Holy Spirit is strumming those strings, but you are to be that sounding board of the Holy Spirit to penetrate this dark world. And everything Christ Jesus does on earth, and everything the Holy Spirit does on earth, both the Son and the Spirit, seek to enlist and use the church, the body of Christ, to accomplish the work. The individual Christian might be called God's middleman or God's contact man. I've not been able to find one case in the New Testament where a sinner was won to Christ without the Holy Spirit using at least one believer as his agent of contact, conviction, and conversion. The Holy Spirit goes by way of the saint to get to the sinner. If you think about Philip. Where did Philip go? He was preaching, had a great work of God in that area, but God just took him. He sent him to the desert to meet one person, Ethiopian eunuch. And there, as the Ethiopian eunuch is reading Isaiah, he's reading about this, about Jesus, and he doesn't even know it. He goes, how can I make sense of this? And Philip proclaims to him Jesus, and then he gets to the point where he understands. He goes, hey, here's water. What prevents me from being baptized? Or you look at Peter. And Peter, when he was in the house of Cornelius, what happened? What's interesting to me about that story, it says the angel went to Peter and said, hey, listen, there's a man I need you to go to. This angel was involved, but the angel was not the main one who went to Cornelius and showed him the gospel. He got Peter, he enlisted Peter to go to Cornelius to preach to him Jesus. And there Cornelius and his family trusted Christ. Could God just have done it himself? Could God have just sent an angel to do it without Peter? But God intends to use us, his people. And if we do not, if we don't go out and preach the gospel, then who will? Will angels do it? Will even he do it alone? God has sovereignly decreed to use his church, his people, to go into the world. So what does Satan do? The great lie that we have believed as a church is that we can pay someone else to do it, or that we can give enough to it, or we can pray enough for it, but just exclude us from that work. That's a big fat lie. He's called us to be salt and light. He's called us to penetrate. He's called us to shine the light of truth and be used of the Holy Spirit and by his power and by his might to go and tell people the truth about the gospel. If we don't do it, then we're going to see a world go straight to a devil's hell. I have more to say on that, but let's go on to the last point. Finally, a word about mercy. God's mercy as he exercises when he sends the Holy Spirit to convict us of sin. The fact that there is even one Christian on earth today is a complete act of mercy, right? God is merciful. But his mercy also extends to commissioning us to go to others. Do you think that's God's mercy in taking you to someone who doesn't know Christ to preach Christ to them? Is that God's mercy? Are you part of being used by God's mercy to tell others about Jesus? Is that God's mercy? It's a blessing. A mercy is a blessing. Grace is a blessing. I have known many, many friends who had serious and major surgeries on something defective or diseased in their bodies. Again and again, I've heard the testimonies after the surgeries. I feel better today than I have in years. Have y'all ever heard that? Y'all been around people who have had massive surgeries, like maybe quadruple bypass surgeries, and they get it done, and after they heal up, they're like, I feel better than I've ever felt before in my life. When the pain and uncertainty of surgery were over, the person was only regretful that he had not had the surgery sooner. Conviction of sin is like major surgery. You may have uneasy feeling that something is wrong. Then a diagnosis is made. You're a sinner going to hell. That's really bad news, doctor. I know. But there's a cure. There's a plan. There's major surgery that we can do to help you on that. So a diagnosis is made. Then you submit to the surgeon. You know, when you go under the knife, you're giving yourself completely to that surgeon. You're being put under, right? You're almost dead. Anesthesia, the reason why anesthesiologists get paid so much money is because literally you are on the brink of death and they're just keeping you barely alive. I mean, that's why they go to you and before you have surgery, they say, hey, listen, so-and-so, we just want you to understand that as we perform the surgery today, you'll be under, we're going to be using these methods to put you under, and you understand that there's a potential that you could, this could be it. I was in the room many times with people. The anesthesiologist came in, and I'm there with that person, and they had that talk. You do understand that you could. There's always a potential of death. Now, we don't like hearing that, right? We go into surgery to get healed. But there's always, right? There's always a truth that you could breathe your last right there on the operating table. But the purpose of this is that you have a problem. You go to the surgeon. You completely submit your whole self to the surgeon. And then he is the one that operates on you so that after the fact, when you get done, you feel better than you've ever felt before. It's the same thing with our sin and the convicting work of the Holy Spirit. He convicts us. We submit ourselves to Christ Jesus wholeheartedly. We don't come halfway. We don't come partially. We say, Jesus, take all of me. I submit all of myself to all that you are. And when we do that, he heals us. Amen. He brings life to our bodies. And that is only by his great mercy. He uses that knife to cut, remove, and repair. Just like the Word of God says, it is a two-edged sword. It is there to cut between spirit and soul, joint and marrow, and knows the thoughts and the intentions of the heart. A double-edged sword, if you can think about it this way, one side is used to cut open to expose the cancer, and the other side is used to remove the cancer. So on one side of the word goes and opens up the flesh, but then the other side comes in to remove the impediment. God's grace is like that, and God's word does that to us. It pierces us to the heart. Remember Acts 2? It says that when they heard the preaching of Peter, what happened? It says they were cut to the heart, pierced to the heart. God's word does that. And so are you going to submit yourself to the surgeon? I don't know if I've met anyone who's gone under major surgery that was just at peace. I've seen Christians go, I know where I'm going. But they're still nervous, right? They're at peace, but they're really nervous. They're going in going, you know, this is going to be a life change for me, right? A life-changing surgery. So conviction is never joyful, is it? Conviction is not designed to be joyful. Conviction is used to show you your need of a Savior. Just like God gave us the law to show us that we couldn't keep the law, so we were convicted by the law so we could see one who kept the law, so that when we then trust in that one who kept the law, then we become justified, those who have actually kept the law. Perfect. This is just God's mercy, and this is God's grace, and this is God's goodness. He is wonderful. And so that is the convicting work of the Holy Spirit. Y'all been through three parts of this. It's been a meaty study. Thank y'all for hanging in there through all this time. I am done. I want to, you can go back there, Dave, and just before, I want to see if there's any questions before we end out this study. We've got about 5 minutes. And so any questions as we've wrapped up our study, is there any questions or anything out there that you would like to ask a question of, anything that you're wanting clarified, anything that you want me to go back to, hey, I missed what you said there, if you could go back and look at that. I just want to make sure that when we end tonight that you're like, I got it, and everything's good. Anybody there on the YouTube universe that you have a question that you would like to ask? Thank you. All right, Tina, I thank you too for being in here. I love you and Dusty so much. Thank you so much for what y'all do for our church. You guys are definitely a blessing. So thank you for tuning in. I pray that you all have been blessed as we have enjoyed this time of the Holy Spirit. I probably will continue this run on the Holy Spirit. We'll probably go back to John 14, and we'll look at some things about the Holy Spirit there, because this is, I believe, one of the things that we as a church, if we're going to go anywhere, we're going to do anything of power, we need to understand more the work of the Holy Spirit. Not by might, not by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. He is the one that's going to build his church, and he's going to use his Spirit, and he's going to use us as we lift up Jesus, and Jesus will draw all men to himself. We are only to be faithful in our sowing, faithful in our gospel witness, and leaving the heavy lifting to the Holy Spirit, who is at work among us, within us, and he's doing that to bring honor and glory to the one who deserves it, and that's our Lord Jesus Christ. All right, so I don't have anything else. Thank you so much. Thank you, Jim. I see that. Thank you for you and Sue. I pray that y'all have a better week. I know from reading Sue's message there on Facebook that you guys will be praying for you as well. Thank y'all so much for tuning in. We definitely miss you. Many of our church members we haven't seen in 2 or 3 months. And so tonight we have Ernie, his family, and Ed, and we see Dave Littlefield and Martha. So it's good kind of getting in the feel of having people come, but we also see it's necessary to have our live stream, and we'll continue that too until we finish this round of our disciple-making training. I will let you know on the universe there on YouTube, we are going to start a fall disciple-making study. That's not going to include you guys. We're going to continue something like this, but we're probably going to reduce the amount of meetings. What I want to do is start breaking you up in small groups and having you reteach a lot of the things that we've been teaching. We've had a good year off and on. We've had a good year that we have material. And now it's time for you guys to get into some small groups and begin to teach this and begin to lead other people through this process. And you're not going to do it perfectly, but the thing is you need to own it. You need to take what you've learned, and now you need to invest time and then repeating that. You always will learn more by teaching than you will just by being a passive listener. And so we want to encourage our disciples to do that so that we can go make more disciples. And that process will continue until Jesus comes again. Be praying for me, too. I'm looking at two mission opportunities in Kenya to do some training. So be praying for support for me. Be praying that I'll be able to prepare the studies. I've been told that I need to prepare for teaching pastors on hermeneutics, and I believe also in exposition or exegesis. So be praying for me as I not only get done with my paper, but also as I prepare to train these pastors in Kenya. And I'm also looking at another trip in Ivory Coast here soon with my friend Abeli. But it's been 2 years. I haven't been on a mission trip, and I'm itching to get out and to do some work in other areas of this world. God is working. He's not only working in America, but he's working, and especially in Africa. He's working in some really great ways. All right. And also, keep in mind, you can also check in to not only our Monday night on your phones. You can also already have online your ability for you to register for this Sunday morning. So be sure, if you're going to plan on being here this Sunday morning, register. We had probably about 60 people or more on Sunday. We had actually a really good crowd. 69. We had 69? I'm glad someone counted. We had 69. We had about 70 people, and that's really a lot of people for this room. And so we're really needing to protect our spaces. So if more of you want to come, we really need to have you register. If we fill up this area, we will have the fellowship hall as an overflow, but please register. If you're online, if you're on YouTube right now, go ahead and register on Church Center. It's so easy. It literally takes you like, what, a minute? Less than a minute? Yeah. It's so easy. So do that for me. That really helps me out. Get ready. I put in little reservations for you. They're on your seats. And so I'm really looking forward to this next Sunday. But I've talked enough. I love you guys. Let's pray, and we'll be dismissed. Lord Jesus, thank you so much that you have sent us the Holy Spirit, who comes to us, who convicts us first of our sin and our deep need of Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. As he convicts us, he regenerates our hearts, he renews us, he raises us from the dead, he brings life to our spirit, and then, Holy Spirit, you use us in the work of convicting this world of sin, righteousness, and judgment. Pray that we would take on the task of being used by you to penetrate darkness by using your word. Pray that tonight on the study that we would use our notes, that we would mull over, we would be like a cow chewing the cud. We would just chew it over and over again, and that we would really own this lesson on that convicting work, that we would even add to this study on what this convicting work really looks like, and we would personalize it to us. I pray, Lord, that you will continue to draw people to Desert Springs as we are on mission to make disciples and to reach our community with the gospel and to see churches planted and California transformed by the mighty gospel. Lord, it's an impossible thing without your spirit, but Lord, we that's why we're doing what we're doing tonight. So that we might be aware, so that we might move, and that we might see impact. Love you. Continue to bring blessings to Desert Springs, your church. Continue to bring honor and glory to your name. And it is to that name that we pray all these things. In the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, so thank y'all very much. Y'all go and have a great night. Get some good sleep, and I'll see you on Sunday.
Yeah.